Welcome to my presentation with the topic Embedded Linux Security, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. A few words on myself. My name is Richard Weinberger. I'm co-founder of a small contracting company that's called Sigma Star GmbH. We work obviously a lot with Linux. Personally, I maintain some minor parts of the kernel. I have a strong focus on kernel stuff, low-level components, virtualization, and security. So today I'm wearing my security hat, also to hide that I'm losing my hair, but that's a different story. Yeah. At my day job, beside of the typical Linux topics, we care a lot about security. Not only security for Linux embedded, also for security for computers in general. For example, we do a lot of source code audits. We also do pen testing, so we try to break systems. And every time when I work with embedded Linux with many customers, I get the feeling they could do a better job. Mostly because I live in both worlds, where I try to build systems and also where I try to break systems. And today I would highlight a few topics that came up into my mind. As I said, it's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, so I need to explain this slide a little bit more. This summer, I learned the hard way that I'm getting old. I was giving a presentation on security and thought it would be fun to have the presentation themed in the color scheme of Sin City. So this old movie, Sin City, all in black with bold colors, but then people asked me, hey Richard, why are you using this strange color scheme? And I said, yeah, that's from the movie Sin City. They have never heard about that. That's I realized, okay, now I'm getting old. So let's explain this also here. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde is a gothic horror story from a British gentleman called Dr. Jekyll. He's a nice gentleman, he knows how to behave, he is well-mannered, all nice and shiny. But he is experimenting with chemicals and he notices that he can transform into a completely different person that shows all of his bad behavior. A very rough and bad person comes out of him, that's Mr. Hyde. And in this story, there is the main plot that Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde transpose back and forth. So sometimes Mr. Jekyll becomes Mr. Hyde, and Mr. Hyde comes back to Mr. Jekyll, and I will not tell you the end, but you can guess what happens. And I thought it's a nice topic to talk about Linux embedded, so then you can decide on yourself whether your little project is more on the Dr. Jekyll side or more on the Mr. Hyde side. First of all, why do we care about security at all? I always thought this is obvious. So I thought I'm young and naive. This is obvious, but as I learned this summer, I'm getting old, so I'm old and naive. It's not obvious. But you should care about security on embedded systems, of course, because there are now some new laws. Mostly important, the Cyber Resilience Act. And also, for example, NIST, there's also some compliance and ESO norms that are really forcing you to design embedded systems you want to sell with a minimum amount of security. Security in terms of that it's not that easy to break something, it's also not that easy to do evil things with it. But you want also, for example, have your system securely to protect your intellectual property. So when you have a cool application, you don't want that everyone can copy it and decipher it and whatever. And sometimes also your customers, made business to client or business to business, want from you a certain level of security that it's secure, that it cannot get a malware infection. And these days, it's really common that you can hack corporate networks using embedded systems or IoT. So the joke, the S in IoT stands for security, is real. Also, often customers tell me, yeah, Richard, I'm not designing a security product. I'm not making a firewall. Why should I care about security? Then I say, yes, but your customers will place your device into the network. And when your device is harming the network, then it will help bad guys to do evil things in the network. That's why you should also care. And with the Cyber Resilience Act and mostly NIST, you will be forced to care. So trust me, you will have to deal with one of these compliance laws sooner or later. They will hit you hard. As I said already, what can happen? We have already many botnets that operate on IoT systems that are really easy, hackable, or also some bigger companies also didn't do their homework properly. Cisco, for example, or Fortinet, they are shipping appliances that are easy hackable because they didn't take enough care about security systems. Also, cars get hacked and no one. And as you know, Linux told already in the keynote, Linux won, Linux is everywhere. So when you design a Linux system, make sure it can be abused. But let's start now. Embedded Linux today is actually a really good shape. We have a lot of ready-to-use hardware available. For example, we have the Raspberry Pi, we have BeagleBones. You can go to various companies, they can give you a ready-to-use board. You can start with creating your product. It's really awesome. And also, the board packages are getting much better. So 15 years ago, the situation with PSP packages was really bad. But these days, you can get from most vendors a good PSP that's not so far away from mainline. So it's a good situation. And of course, as you can see, the community is huge. There are many people you can talk to, and you can get help. It's all good. And we have many cool projects made, Yocto, made Buildroot, Qt, all nice projects. You can build really great products using Linux. So, of course, that's why we have here Dr. Jack Hill. And Linux actually offers everything you need to lock down your embedded system. It offers the basic stuff like file permissions, made decreasingly access control, so chmod, also access control lists. We have also advanced permissions. For example, you can use them with SE Linux or AppArmor. We have also everything to make sure that your file system stays integral, so integrity stuff. We can also have disk encryption and authentication. Here's one thing I want to point out especially. Encrypting the disk just with the mcrypt is not enough. When you want to make sure for data integrity, you need also, for example, on a block layer, something like DM Verity or DM Integrity. Because just because an attacker cannot read your data doesn't mean he cannot change it. In most cases, it will decipher to something like garbage, but a really smart attacker can change bits accordingly, then it will decrypt to something sane or exchange blocks. And there have already been practical attacks on the mcrypt just by replacing blocks. And most of the new compliance laws force you to also make sure for data integrity. But we have also strong cryptography, so we won the crypto wars. We can have good ciphers. We have them in user space and kernel space. We have trusted and verified boot. So Ruben from Penguitronics gave yesterday a really cool talk on verified boot. I recommend it. So I will not dive too much into these details. We have also all kind of hardening stuff. We have ASLL, so address-based layout randomization in user space and kernel space. It make it much harder for attackers to exploit bugs. We have also all kind of sandboxing, so you can confine your application. When your application has a bug, then it won't be that bad. So it's already there. You may now wonder, okay, what's the problem? You have also to use this stuff. Just because it's there, it doesn't mean it's automatically configured or it does the right thing. So usually when you have, for example, a Yocto, then you get a more or less same default, but you have to work on that. And it's rather easy that you do something that will void these security measurements. So just to give you a few examples, Yocto has a good set of default compiler flags. So the default compiler flags, for example, enable fortify source that the C applications are protected, but when your make files are resetting the compiler flags, then your application cannot benefit from that. And that's something obvious, but you have to care about that. Or what I really see way too often is that the application on a device depends on legacy legacy libraries, like an old OpenSSL library. Then you are also out of luck. When your OpenSSL is completely buggy and outdated, then all the hardening won't help you much because it's basically exploitable. Also, when your application is not 64 bits safe, many of the modern security features require 64 bits. So on, for example, 32 bits, the address space is so small that the randomization doesn't make a lot of sense. And what I also see too often, that the whole application just runs as root. As I said before, we have basic file permissions. When everything runs as root, you don't have to worry about file permissions. But not, let's focus also on hardware features. So I told you also example about verified boot. So verified boot, of course, depends on the hardware. Your hardware vendor has to support this. What's lesser known is also disk encryption. So when I enable disk encryption on my laptop, it's supported since years on SUSE, easy. I have to type in the password at boot up. When your embedded device asks you at every boot up for the password, I'm pretty sure your customers will hate you. So you have to store the password somewhere on the device that the device can use the password to unlock the disk, but then an attacker who has physical access cannot extract the password. That's not so easy. This is why we need a secure element. On the PC, usually you have a TPM, so trusted platform module. On an embedded system, you have mostly something that is specific to the system on chip. So here, two examples from NXP, the data coprocessor and the CAM engine. There are more, but these are all under NDA. I'm not allowed to talk about them. The problem is with these, many of these components need special drivers that are not mainline. And when they are not mainline, you have a batch set you have to carry on your own. And these drivers are often in really bad shape, and then they will also hurt your overall security. So this can be a challenge, especially when you depend on a system, on a SOC vendor that has a bad motherboard package. I mentioned this already. When the application just runs as root, you have a problem. This is fine for proof of concept, but later you really may have to make sure that the application is split up in multiple components that do not need root permissions, because then you can apply all the security measurements. So when the application is compromised, then it can not so easily take over the rest of the system. When everything runs as root, then exploiting the rest is easy. And I will do it later, will just not work. Because when you have a huge code base that will run only as root, it's hard to figure out what files do we need for writing, what component needs what. So you need to do this in the early days. Doing this afterwards is a lot of effort. The next bigger thing I would like to highlight is maintenance. So building a product is a lot of work, but compared to maintenance, building is easy. So when you're in the position to maintain a product for, say, 5 or 10 years, then you have really a hard time, and this is a challenge. This is often completely underestimated. Basically, to make sure that a system can live for a long time, it offers you two ways. So always upgrade to the latest and greatest. So whenever there's a new version, you upgrade, maybe the kernel or some library or Yocto-based system, or you freeze your software version and backport fixes on your own. So basically, this means you do what Red Hat or SUSE does. Both of these can work, but none of them is cheap and is easy. And there's also a third option I'm not going to talk about. Let's focus more on always upgrade. This is, in my opinion, the easiest one. So for example, you have your embedded application that runs on some kind of system built with Yocto, Buildroot, or Debian, whatever. And every time your base OS, so Yocto, gives you a new release, a new upgrade, make sure that the application runs on that, and that way you get all the security fixes for free. That's a good approach to stay secure. The problem is your application has to be designed in a good way. So when you upgrade components, then the programming API will change. So mostly libcute, OpenSSL, they actually change in their programming API, and then you have to adopt and recompile your application. And depending on your application, this can be easy or absolutely no way. So I know many applications that are completely stuck with libcute version 5. They have no way to upgrade to version 6. And of course, when you upgrade, you basically change the version of every software component, and you need a full QA cycle. So you need to have a really, really good testing infrastructure to make sure that you have no regressions. And having and the need for a good QA cycle is mostly why many people think, okay, let's backport, it's easier. So they stay with what they have and say, okay, whenever there's a security bug fix, we will backport that to our base. This can work, and for the first few years, it's okay-ish, but latest after 5 years, you are mostly deep in trouble. The problem is, let's assume there's a security vulnerability for OpenSSL version 3 dot whatever. They're filing a CVE and give you a patch. Then you have to decide and figure whether this vulnerability affects your very old version, and you have to create a fix on your own. And further, you get CVEs only for supported software versions. When in your old version some bug is found, nobody cares. They care only about the supported version. So this is basically the main business from SUSE and Red Hat, and they have many people that make sure that Red Hat and SUSE Enterprise Linux stays stable on the old versions, and this is a huge effort. And as I said, I'm not going to talk about the third option. You can conclude yourself from the image what I think about that. The next thing is the kernel. Even when you have a really nice and shining base system based on Yocto, the chance is extremely great that you have a kernel from your board support package vendor. That can be in good shape, but don't have to be. Usually, you maintain the kernel on your own. When you're really, really lucky, you can use the kernel as is from for example, Yocto or Buildroot, and you will almost never be able to use the kernel from a supported distro like Debian or such. So, it really depends on the BSP quality when it comes to the kernel quality. So when you are stuck with some old board support package and you cannot upgrade because you don't have the whole set of drivers, you will have every time kernel bugs. And kernel bugs mean vulnerabilities. And this is a real problem. And this can end in a security nightmare. This is one of the main reasons why people decide we do nothing, because upgrading the kernel is too much. We don't do it. But that way, you are all open for security breaches. I mentioned it also already briefly, tracking CVEs isn't as easy as it might be. So first of all, CVEs apply only to supported software. As far as software version is no longer supported, you will no longer get CVEs. And CVEs usually apply only to the latest and greatest. When you're lucky, a CVE will tell you which versions might be affected, but there's a might, but this is just mostly a random guess. And it's also often the case that you don't get CVEs at all. So many software projects don't assign CVEs on their own. So in my day job, I also find often vulnerabilities in open source components, and I talk to the project maintainer, hey, there's a security bug, do you want to file a CVE? No, I don't do it. Then it's my job as a security researcher, and filing CVEs is work, and it takes time. So there's a good chance that you have vulnerabilities in your projects that which are unknown to the CVE system. And when you have multiple thousands of packages, it's also hard to do this by hand. So there are some tools available, for example, in Yocto, that will help you finding CVEs, so known CVEs for your software components, but that's just best effort. And beside of that, depending on how old your software is, you will also have to read the change logs. So many bug fixes are not stated as a security bug fix. You have to read the changelog while upgrading and figure yourself whether you want to backport a bug fix or not. It used to be for the kernel for many years before we start the CVE DDoS attack. But there's still hope. So first of all, try to let others do the hard work. So we have already Linux distributions, for example, Debian. Debian will give you a maintained Linux system for a few years. Whenever you can, try to use Debian as base. Yocto is really, really great. With Yocto and BuildRoot, you can do whatever you want. You can create your own distribution. But when you can reuse Debian and are fine with the Debian way of life, then you get a free OS completed for free, and all you have to do is build your application on top of that. So that's why when people ask me for Yocto training, the first thing is always I ask, okay, why not Debian? Tell me why Debian doesn't fit for you. And in many cases, they never thought about that. They thought for embedded, you have to use Yocto. No, you have to use Yocto when you want to create your own thing. Chances are great that I can use Debian. When you want to use something like Yocto, always stay with a recent release. So upgrade as often as possible. And of course, keep your application in shape. When the application is in good shape, then you can try what will happen when I have to upgrade now. Then you see, okay, the next library, whatever, changes the programming API, I need to keep this in mind. Then I can talk to your manager, hey, in half a year, there will be work, we have to change our application because the API has changed, but look ahead. Don't get surprised. It's more or less obvious, but please try to avoid out of three patches. Send patches upstream, of course, and try to use a mainline kernel as much as possible and keep your batch queue small. So the less patches you have to carry and maintain on your own, the easier it will be to upgrade the kernel. I'm fully aware that you can never have zero patches. You will always have patches for your kernel, but try to keep them minimal. Try to talk to the upstream maintainers. Maybe there's a better solution. Maybe with a new release, you don't need an out-of-tree driver. Maybe someone else has upstream, but keep it in shape such that upgrading is easy. And also, don't tie yourself too close to a specific piece of hardware. So with full disk encryption and authentication based on hardware and also with verified boot, you have to do some things specific for your system on chip. But keep in mind, there are also others. So keep the hardware specific things in their own corner in your system and make sure that you have an option to switch to something else. When you have to figure out yourself what is where, then it will be a lot of work. Because sometimes hardwares are canceled, you have to switch to a new platform rather fastly, then it will be a problem. When you know exactly this and that, then it's much more easier. This brings me already to my summary. As I said, Linux already offers everything you need to build a secure system, but it's up to you to use it properly. And it's also the simple things like file permissions, what you have to use it. Don't underestimate maintenance. This is a lot of work, and it's usually more work than building the system. And software is a moving target, and that's why you should keep your application in shape. So make sure that Mr. Hyde doesn't take over and keep on Dr. Jekyll's side. So thanks for your attention, and I'm open for questions. I have a few more minutes, so if you're interested, I have backup slides, but first try questions. Thank you. No questions? That's good. Then I will show you a few more slides. It's your fault. Nah, just kidding. There is one thing I didn't talk about. Usually these days, your embedded system will talk to kind of a cloud. So your embedded system is connected to something. So the backend is part of the architecture. And it's of course also important to keep the backend securely. So at some point, maybe there's a vulnerability in your cloud that somebody can back connect to your, device. So the cloud can also be in an attack vector. So this is something that people often underestimate. When you have, for example, a VPN connection to the cloud, the connection can go inside. So don't trust necessarily the backend. Also, when you develop software, so your application, make sure that you follow secure coding guidelines. Know all your dependencies. This is also something that I often encounter, that people don't know what are the dependencies. The software just runs, but don't know why. When you know your dependencies, you also know where to look for supply chain attacks. When you have a million dependencies, that's a problem. When you have just a few, you can look into it. Know all your resources, CPU, memory, and files. So CPU and memory is good for make sure that each part of the application gets its resources. Knowing which files you depend on is, for example, important when you apply security measurements like SE Linux, where you can really control the file permissions for the applications. Many big applications are so big that nobody knows anymore what files they need to read and write. It just works and runs as root. When possible, also use sandboxing. So lock in the application in itself that you can work against the evildoers when your application has a problem. And of course, QA is important. Have somebody that looks into it. Maybe you can hire somebody that looks at the source code to do a pen test. Certifications are not needed, but have a look at them, what they require. So it's sometimes really funny what a certification wants from you. So maybe at some point a customer wants you to have a certification, whatever, and when you have already looked into it, you know what will happen. Then you can get that badly surprised. This is already something that Ruben explained. When you use secure boot, your device will contain secrets, and the evildoers sooner or later will break your device and get access to these keys. When you're using the very same disk encryption key for all devices out there, that's really not so smart. Also make sure that at the production suite, you have somebody you can trust. When you don't trust your production suite, you are also kind of in trouble because you hand over them your key material. So, in deployment, as I said, the device will be at your enemies. So avoid identical secrets on your devices that will be otherwise a problem. At some point, somebody will open at least one device, and when the passwords and keys are known, then they can open everything else. So now, finally, I'm really done. Thank you for your attention. Any questions? No. That's a question. Yeah. Do we have a mic?
So maybe just repeat the question.
Yeah.
So I was wondering if you have a project or a product that is already in production and you want to retrofit it to fit those requirements to make it secure, how would you actually start?
So the question was, when I have already a finished project, how can I start with securing it? Yeah, that's a hard question. So I would recommend trying to find documentation on it, read the change logs, and talk to the person that is more or less the product owner, that you can more or less decipher on your own how it was built. I don't see him. Is that a question?
Yeah.
I can't hear you. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
You have to stand up and yell.
Is there really no mic here for questions? Gibt's heute?
Yeah, thank you. I have a just general question, it's architecture related. I personally believe it's impossible to 100% protect an entire Linux system, and you can only add more and more features and lock the system down. Then we would get some disadvantages of the amazing features of the kernel we have. And my question is, it would be a better implementation if we say we only protect the most vulnerable items, like the user data, like the interface to the hardware, and keep the other things like web interface, web browser, open and allow attacks in that.
Yeah, so the question is whether it's better to just protect the user data and quasi accept the fact that we can get hacked anyway. Of course, so you always have to keep in mind that at some point your device will get hacked and protect your data for sure, but you don't have to make it super easy for the bad guys. So when you can apply hardening, do it. But always keep in mind at some point that you will have a data breach.
The thing of the trust zone and the untrust. Restricted, non-restricted.
Yes, but the trust zone was also many times hacked.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thanks for... Yeah, question.
Is there like a performance trade-off when hardening the system?
So the question is whether there's a performance trade-off when you harden a system. It depends, of course, on the type of hardening. For example, when you apply SE Linux, then the SE Linux policy has to evaluate it on each file access. There are caches, but it has a certain overhead. But these days, with the big embedded systems, you will be a hard time to measure it. Thanks.